Kids, this is Pastor Debbie. Welcome to Kids Church. I am super excited to unpack God's Word with you today. Our new series is called Questions, Questions, Questions. And today's question is, what would you gain if you gained the whole world but lost your soul? Before we dig into God's Word this morning, let's prepare our hearts to worship Him. Let's pray. Raise up your hands and bow your heads. Father, in the name of Jesus, I ask you to come close to us this morning as we worship you in spirit and in truth, Father. I pray, Lord, that we would use our hands, our feet, our bodies, our minds, but most importantly, our hearts and our spirits to worship you. Your word says that when we worship you, your presence draws near to us, and we stand on the promises of your word. In Jesus' name, and everybody said, amen. Let's worship the Lord.
Thank you. thousand stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard tender whispers of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good father.
We're going to meet some new friends during this series, and who best to ask questions than a kindergarten or first grade class? Be prepared to giggle as you watch.
Good morning, first grade.
Good morning, Mr. Periwinkle.
As some of you may remember, today is show and tell. I'd asked each of you to bring something from home that you love more than anything else in the whole world. Now, who would like to go first?
I will.
Well, wonderful, Stacy. Come on up and share with the class.
Okay. I brought an apple because apples are good for your health. You know, an apple a day keeps the doctor away. Plus, I know that teachers like apples, so I thought, give an apple away, and teacher will give you an A. Apples? Man, I'm from the Bronx. In the Bronx, we eat rocks. We're tough.
Rock fighters. Bronxy rock fighters.
What'd I miss? What slimed my desk?
We're still having show and tell. Please stay awake and pay attention, and please wipe your mouth. Thank you, Stacy. I can't guarantee you an A because you gave me this apple, but if you had brought me an Apple iPod, then that's a different story. You know, Apple, iPod, Apple, the company.
So you're saying if we want an A, we have to buy you expensive gifts?
No, that's not what I mean at all.
Mr. Periwinkle, I don't think this is very ethical. In fact, I believe Principal Constipation would not approve of this.
Well, actually, his name is Principal Constantine, and let's just drop it and move on. Let's have TJ. You're next.
What?
It's your turn.
Oh, okay. This is the thing that's most important to me in the world. This is my Blanky. I call him Blanky. He keeps me company and protects me when I'm scared or worried.
That's about right. That blanket's the only friend you got.
Susan, that is not nice. Thank you, TJ. Next up, Fitzgerald. Fitzgerald?
Fitzy, it's your turn.
What? Oh yeah, show and tell. Okay. I brought something. This ball of lint. It's very important.
Now, why is this something that you love more than anything else?
Because this could save your life. One time I was out stuck in the wilderness and I used this ball of lint to start a fire.
You did? When were you stuck in the wilderness?
Just the other day, I was stuck out in the snow and my sister had gotten mad, right? And so she turned the whole place into like ice and snow and stuff. It was everywhere. And then I met this guy named Kristoff and his reindeer named Sven. And then we saw this like snowman and he was singing about summer.
Man, you got lint in your head. That's the plot from the movie Frozen. You don't know what you're talking about. Sit down, it's my turn. I brought money. Money is what I love more than anything.
Why do you love money so much?
Because it takes money to buy stuff. And I have a lot of cool stuff. Better than all your blankies, apples, and lint balls.
Hey, my blankie is way better than your money. It keeps me warm.
Oh, hey, lint balls are great. You can even eat them. They're high in fiber. I think this is my mom's hair. And it kind of looks like Kevin Bacon.
Money is more important than anything. And who's Kevin Bacon?
Well, how do you not know Kevin Bacon? I don't know. Kevin Bacon's my friend. You have a blanket on your head.
Wow, it looks like our friends are definitely mixed up. Money, blankets, and apples are great. But they are far from the thing we should love more than anything. The Bible is very clear that we should love God more than anything else. The things of this world like money, possessions, and stuff won't last forever. They are here today, then they are gone. But God lasts forever. He is way more important than stuff. Today you are going to learn from another big question Jesus asked. He asked, "What do you benefit if you gain the whole world but lose your own soul?" That means, what good would it do you if you have all the money in the world, but you lose your relationship with God? That's a very important question that we need to answer. Today, you are going to learn from a story Jesus told called The Parable of the Rich Fool. You're going to learn that you must always love God more than your stuff. My name is Kayla, and I'll see you next time when we learn more of Jesus' questions, questions, questions.
Thanks, class. Oh, that was so funny. Now, I have a couple of questions that I'd like you to think about and to answer while we're going through our lesson. Are you ready? Now, if you want to answer the question, just like in class, you want to raise your hand. So let's practice that. Up, down, up, down, up, down, up, down. Okay, I think you've got it. So the first question is, what is your favorite toy or game? Everybody's going to have a different answer, but what is your favorite toy or game? My favorite game is Monopoly, but nobody likes to play it with me at home because it takes such a long time. How much time do you spend on a daily or weekly basis playing your favorite game or playing with your favorite toy? How much time do you spend? I don't spend very much time playing Monopoly because, like I said, I can't get people to play Monopoly with me because it takes such a long time, but it doesn't mean I don't enjoy it. The other thing I like to do are word searches, and so I'll spend maybe 30 minutes every day doing word searches. Now, the next question is, what book of the Bible do you like the best? It could be your favorite. It could be just the one that you really like the best. It could possibly be the one that you just read. So that's a hard pick for me because I love God's Word and I like so many of the books. But I think if I had to choose, I would pick the book of John because it's so uplifting and it begins to tell us all about Jesus and who he is and all of the things that he taught. It tells us about his great love for us, for you and for me. So I think that's probably my favorite book. And then the last question I want you to think about is, what is your favorite scripture? Or maybe the first one that comes to mind. I have so many favorites. Of course, I can think of John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son, that whoever believes in him will not perish, not die, but have everlasting life. Okay, that's one of my favorites. But I also have another favorite, 2 Chronicles 7:14. If my people, who are called by my name, will humble themselves and pray and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear their cries from heaven and I will heal their land. Oh, all scripture is God-breathed. All scripture is awesome. All scripture is worthy. But I want you to be thinking about that as we take a look at the big question today by reviewing from the book of Luke, chapter 12, verses 13 through 21. But before we do that, let's see what's up with Skittles.
What's up?
Ah, yeah, what's up, everybody? It's me, the SKI to the double TLES, Skittles in the Hizzy, and I'm ready to tell you what's up. Today, we are talking about loving God more than anything else in this world. So every time today that somebody asks you, what's up, you tell them, God matters more than my stuff. Can you believe it? Some people love the things of this world more than God. Stuff like money, possessions, friends, whatever. But even though none of those things are necessarily bad, we can't give anything in exchange for our soul, baby. God has got to be number one. So anytime, I mean anytime, if somebody asks you, what's up, you tell them, God matters more than my stuff. And that's what's up. I got a rainbow of flavor, and I'm living for my savior. Skittles out. Bang, bang, yeah. Wiggity, 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 yo. What's up?
Okay, kids, today I'd like to share a story from the book of Luke, chapter 12, verses 13 through 21. We find that Jesus was teaching a large group of people. In fact, the Bible records that there were so many people in the crowd that they were stepping on each other. That is really crowded. And suddenly, a man interrupted Jesus and began complaining about a family member who owed him money. He wanted Jesus to make the man divide up the property and all their possessions rather than working it out himself. Can you imagine? The man was so concerned with his money, he thought it was more important than hearing Jesus teach. He was willing to interrupt him. He actually interrupted Jesus. Oh, how rude. Jesus knew there were many people in the crowd, though, who loved their money and their stuff way more than they should. And Jesus used every opportunity to teach the truth. He He never let any opportunity go by. So he told them a story, a parable, of a very rich man. This man owned a lot of stuff. In fact, this man owned so much land, cattle, grain, and stuff that he didn't even have enough storage space to store it all. One day, the rich man was looking out on all of his land and possessions, and he said to himself in verse 18, "I'll tear down my barns and build bigger ones to hold all of my possessions." He didn't think to share his stuff with the poor or to give some of it to the church or anything like that. All he thought about was himself and his stuff. At that very moment, God spoke to the man. And verse 20 records that God said this, "You fool, you are going to die tonight. Then who will get everything that you've worked for?" And do you know what happened? That's exactly what happened. That night, the man died. Kids, that man was so focused on his stuff, and now his life was over. How much of his stuff do you think he got to take with him when he died? Yeah, that's right. None of it. Jesus was making a point with this parable or story. He was teaching an important truth. And the truth was this: focusing on money, possessions, and stuff is just not worth it. All of that stuff is worth nothing. Zip, zero, nada when we die. Instead, we should focus our time, energy, and passion on the things of God. Only a relationship with God will matter once we die. All of the other stuff won't matter at all. You may have heard the phrase, "You can't take it with you." Well, that is certainly true. You can't take your stuff with you to heaven. But God will be there, Jesus and the Holy Spirit, they'll all be there, waiting for you with open arms. It is the relationship that you take with you. Today we're going to explore Jesus' important question. What do you benefit if you gain the whole world but lose your soul? Listen carefully. This lesson will change your life. Before we dig deeper into God's Word, let's hear from our new friend Coach with today's power verse.
And quality of sporks in the kitchen. But it's all good. I'm going to teach you our power verse today. Today, our power verse is this: and what do you benefit if you gain the whole world but lose your own soul? Mark 8:36. All right, now Coach needs all the fellas to stand up where you're at, and you're going to help Coach do the power verse. If you don't, it's a technical foul. Here we go. Ready? 1, 2, 3. And what do you benefit if you gain the whole world but lose your own soul? Mark 8:36. Great job, boys. You can sit down. Now I need all the ladies to stand up and see if you can sing even louder than the boys. Ready? 1, 2, 3. And what do you benefit if you gain the whole world but lose your own soul? Mark 8:36. Great job! Great job, girls. You did good. You can sit down. Ooh. Now, this reminds me, Coach, when I first started, I wanted a gold whistle. Now, I would have done anything to get this gold whistle. I was thinking about it. I was dreaming about it. Coach, stop going to work. Coach, stop working out. It was bad. Then I realized, look, it doesn't matter. The stuff doesn't make you happy. Plus, Coach was starting to get a little flabby. That's what was happening. So boys and girls, just remember, keep God number one. Your stuff isn't gonna make you happy. So let's do our power verse one more time together, but this time with the physical challenge. Okay, I want everybody to stand up, and this time, while you do your power verse, we're gonna pretend that we're bench pressing 500 pounds. Ready? Here we go. 1, 2, 3. 36! Good job, everybody! You can sit down. Now listen, Coach has got to go back and start making some milk steaks. Don't worry, they're going to be delicious. I'll see you next week. All right, where's that milk?
Well, let's practice today's power verse a couple more times. On the count of three. One, two, three. And what do you benefit if you gain the whole world but lose your soul? Mark 8:36. And what do you benefit if you gain the whole world but lose your soul? Mark 8:36. Let's say it slowly. And what do you benefit if you gain the whole world but lose your soul? Mark 8:36.
Wiggity 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 yo! What's up?
That is an awesome question. I hope you're thinking about it, and I hope you're thinking about the questions I asked you earlier about your favorite toy or game and how much time you spend playing with them or doing that activity. Well, now let's look further into the word and find out, how does it apply to you and me? So, what's it worth? Jesus asked the question, what do you benefit if you gain the world but lose your soul? Let's consider his question together. Have you ever wanted to be rich? I mean super rich, with so much money and stuff you didn't know what to do with it all? How many of you have ever dreamed about having a huge house with a big, deep, Olympic-sized swimming pool and a 100-inch flat-screen TV with the latest video gaming system and every game that has ever been created? Have you ever thought that would just be awesome? Jesus used an example in Luke 12 about a man who had it all. For the time he lived, he had everything you can imagine. Big house, lots of cattle, many barns to hold his possessions. He was basically living the dream. And that's the life I was just describing to you by today's standards. But I have one question for you. What happened to him? Yep, that's right. He died without God in his life. So what was it worth for him to have all that stuff in the end? It wasn't worth anything. It was worth nothing. Nothing is worth more than our relationship with God. In the end, it didn't matter how much stuff the rich man had, did it? He ended up dying and losing it all anyway. But the sad part is, he died without God in his life. He didn't know Jesus. When it came to spiritual things, he was not a rich man at all. As a matter of fact, kids, he was a very poor man without God. He didn't know Jesus. He wasn't born again, and he didn't have a ticket to heaven. Remember, kids, Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the Father except through me. We must realize that nothing, 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 nothing is worth more than having a relationship with God. Why? Well, because money and stuff won't last forever. When we die, just like the rich fool, we won't be able to take our stuff with us. You'll never see a hearse going down the street pulling a U-Haul trailer behind it with all the dead person's stuff in it. You know why? Because the person is dead, but their stuff is still here. It has to stay on earth. They can't take it with them when they die. So think about gaming systems, fancy American Girl dolls, football, lots of money, oh, an iPhone, yes, all of these things. This stuff is fun, and it's wonderful, and there's nothing wrong with having nice things. But when all you think about and spend your time on is getting more and more and more and more and more of this stuff, then you're ignoring the thing that really matters. You're ignoring your relationship with God. That is the only thing that will last forever. Your relationship, our relationship with God, is the only thing that lasts forever, not your stuff. How sad would it be that you spent your whole life trying to get the latest, greatest stuff, but ignored your relationship with God? There's a lot of people like that. When you die, which of the stuff is going to go with you? None of it. Absolutely none of it. If we're not to live our lives to get more money and stuff, what should we do? Well, Jesus told us that we should do this. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. And what does that mean? Well, it means this: I must make God number one in my life. Kids, we must love God more than we love money, toys, clothes, computers, electronics, big swimming pools, fancy cars, all of that stuff. If we focus more time on playing video games than we do spending time with God, we've got it all wrong. Those video games are not going to get us to heaven. If we refuse to give offering because we want to save the money to buy more candy or toys, then obviously we love stuff more than God. That means we're like a fool, just like the man in the Bible parable in the book of Luke. If we're going to make a difference in the world and live the lives that God wants us to live, we must love God more than stuff. So how do we do that? We need to let go of our stuff and spend more time, energy, and focus on building our relationship with Jesus. We need to build our relationship with Jesus every single day. We need to make God and Jesus number one in our lives, because He's the one who's going to last forever, not our stuff. Now, does that mean that we can't have stuff, that we can't enjoy our stuff, or that we can't use our stuff to lead people into relationship with Jesus? Well, no, of course not. God wants to give us every good and perfect gift. His word says that. Every good and perfect gift comes from God. Amen? Well, let's pray together, kids, because we always have a friend in Jesus who will help us make Him number one. So let's stand up as we pray today, and let's dedicate our stuff to God. Let's decide to pursue Jesus with more passion and excitement than we pursue getting the latest and greatest stuff. Are you standing? Stand up. Raise your hands. Let's pray. Pray with me. Father, in the name of Jesus, we stand before you today and we dedicate all our stuff, all of our possessions to you. We understand that you are more important than anything. And we commit to use our possessions to help others come into relationship with you. Give us creative ways and ideas that we can do that. Right now, I pray for us all to admit when we haven't made you our number one priority. And I ask you to forgive us for our lack of obedience, our poor attitudes, and making our stuff an idol, and for all of our mistakes. I ask you to strengthen us in our minds, our spirits, and help us to be obedient no matter what. Help us put you first in all things. We need you, Lord. We can't do this on our own. Lord, I pray for each of us to put you first. And when we do that, your word says that all things will be given to us. You take such good care of your children, and you are the best Daddy God ever. Thank you for forgiveness. Thank you for your mercy. Thank you for your love. And thank you, Lord, for your word. In Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen and amen. Well, kids, I hope you'll join us next time as we explore another one of Jesus's tough questions.